शहीद करबला है ये, रसूल की दुआ है ये, हुसैनो मिन्नी व अना मिनल हुसैन।
दिस इज पीटीवी वर्ल्ड, आई एम सैयद शबाहत अली। वेलकम टू द स्पेशल ट्रांसमिशन ऑफ मुहर्रम अल हराम। 10th ऑफ मुहर्रम इज कमेमोरेटेड एवरी ईयर टू रिमेंबर द ग्रेट सैक्रिफाइस of Sayyid Imam Hussain alayhi salam. Imam Hussain, the grandson of Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and son of Sayyid Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, was one of the major leaders of Islamic world that came out for this great sacrifice, which is remembered every year by billions of Muslims. These days reminds us of the tragedies he faced, of the character that he possessed, and of the sacrifices that are so immensely remembered and resonates in the entire world to date. I'm joined by a prestigious guest who will help us to understand the political environment in which Imam Hussain took this wonderful initiative. My first guest in today's program is Ali Murtaza, who is a graduate of St. John College of Cambridge University and a political scientist. Ali, welcome to the program.
Thank you for having me. It's an honor.
Can you help me to understand the political environment when Imam Hussain alayhi salam came forward for this greatest sacrifice of human history?
Well, Imam Hussain was the testament trustee and the inheritor of the virtues of all the prophets. While Yazid wanted to annihilate Islam by pressurizing such a personality like Imam Hussain to swear allegiance to an evil man like himself, it was a question of life and death of the faith, Islam, while the efforts and strivings of all the prophets depended on Imam Hussain. I always like to quote Thomas Carlyle, who was a Scottish historian, who said, "In the history of Islam, especially the life of Imam Hussain stands unique, unapproached and unapproachable by anyone. Without his martyrdom, Islam would have extinguished long ago. He was the savior of Islam, and it was due to his martyrdom that Islam took such deep roots, which is neither possible nor even imaginable to destroy today."
Ali, can you help me to understand the political environment of that time when a tyrant wanted Imam Hussain for his allegiance, and what was the environment that actually brought him to the point of this great sacrifice?
Well, basically what had happened was that over a period of time, after the death of the Holy Prophet and the Islamic Empire grew, along the way, the Ummah started to lose the notions and the norms that had been taught by the Holy Prophet. And it is because of Imam Hussain that we are now able to see Islam in its form, because otherwise it would have been extinguished.
I think that
the most important, if I may, the most important, the movement of Imam Hussain was really the establishment of the truth and justice. As Imam Hussain said himself, "Indeed, I have risen up to solely seek and reform the Ummah of my grandfather. I want to command what is good and stop what is wrong." In my opinion, the Battle of Karbala is not a clash between personalities, but between two principles: love of truth against lust of power, passion for justice against the severity of tyranny.
Ali, I understand what you said, but can you narrow this down, or let me rephrase my question again? Like, what I'm trying to understand is the political significance for Hussain not compromising on his principles and giving this great sacrifice. How does it affect Islam in the world, in the order that we see today? What would have been the case if he would have not given the sacrifice? How could it have affected the structure of Islam in its very origin?
in my opinion, Imam Hussain is really the embodiment of valor and personification of sacrifice and devotion. Basically, just when the Muslim empire had reached the pinnacle of glory, Imam Hussain, the grandson of the Holy Prophet, challenged the legitimacy and tyranny of the Yazidis. Imam Hussain sealed his fate with his blood and the blood of his family when he and his companions were martyred while fighting against the heaviest of odds, against hordes of armies. Imam Hussain fought valiantly against tyranny and persecution. As I said earlier, I think that the Battle of Karbala is a clash not between personalities but principles.
We are again living in a turbulent political environment. We see agony, pain, conflict, and disaster hitting every part of this world that we live in. So in these times when the days of Muharram come, how do you personally connect yourself with the event of Karbala? And what lesson does Imam Hussain's sacrifice teach you in the light of the events that we are facing in this world today?
I think the best answer to this is the story of Karbala teaches us to stand up for our rights and to preserve as well as uphold human values and virtues, to stand up against tyranny and persecution. I think it is the only example in history where the victim or the personality that lost the battle actually lived on and is immortal. I mean, I think the best example is that Imam Hussain had only about 70-odd companions. But today, if you see the millions of people that go and pay homage on pilgrimage, I think that in itself is testament to Imam Hussain. I think I always like the saying that Imam Hussain said, death with dignity is better than a life of humiliation.
Thank you very much, Ali, for enlightening us with your wonderful thought for the program. It was such an honor to have you in this program. Ladies and gentlemen, my second guest in the program comes from the world of academia. He is an assistant professor in Qaid-e-Azam University. He holds a doctorate degree from University of Tehran. Dr. Kandil Abbas is my second guest in the show. Dr. Welcome to the program.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Abbas, we are talking about the great sacrifice of Sayyidina Imam Hussain alayhi salam. And most of my viewers would like to understand this from its foundation. Can you kindly elaborate the significance of Imam Hussain as his person? Can you introduce him, who he is, and why he stands to be such a significant personality for Muslims across the world?
Thank you very much. Imam Hussain alayhi salam is in fact one of the grandsons of Prophet, peace be upon him, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And his brother was named Hassan alayhi salam. And these two brothers are in fact last descendants of Prophet, peace be upon him, who were living in the time of Prophet, peace be upon him, and they remain even after his demise. They were part of Prophet's Ahlul Bayt, which are known as household of Prophet, and they have certain specific place in Ahlul Bayt. Particularly, they were declared as masters and chiefs of youth though in Jannah or in paradise. So that is the significance. And similarly, once Prophet said, Hussain minni wa ana min al Hussain. Hussain is from me and I am from Hussain. This is showing that this is a Prophet had very close relation with particularly Hussain al-Islam. And the duty or the mission Hussain had was a sacred mission, and that mission was for human being, not for particular school of thought. Because at that time, in fact, Yazid, a criminal person, was declaring himself as a leader of Muslims at that time and declaring himself as a caliphate. That was the religious title at that time.
As the Caliph of Muslims.
Exactly. Under that title, he was trying to implement and impose inhuman practices in the society. And that was the very critical challenge for a person like Imam Hussain alayhi salam, because he was responsible, the only responsible and main responsible at that time to protect all those teachings which were in fact delivered by, inculcated by last 124,000 prophets. And during that whole period, they were trying to guide human being what is the legitimate way of human life. So at the time of last prophet, peace be upon him, all these things were almost concluded. And after that, this responsibility was accepted by the household of Prophet, and particularly Imam Hassan al-Islam and Imam Hussain al-Islam. So when Yazid started to implement those inhuman practices in the society, Imam Hussain stood against those practices to reinstate those original Islamic teaching in the society.
Doctor, but if Imam Hussain would have accepted him to be the caliph of that time, since I understand, and correct me if I'm mistaken on that, that he was not a candidate or was not contesting for the position of being the symbolic caliph of Islam, then why would he sacrifice his life? Why would he just not allow the caliph to call himself the caliph? And what caliph exactly wanted out of Hussain for which he had to make this huge sacrifice?
The position was not main objective of Imam Hussain al-Islam.
He was not contesting for the position.
But he was feeling his own responsibility, because during the time of Imam Hassan al-Islam, when there were conflicts in the society, he was also trying to perform his duties. But at the time of Imam Hussain al-Islam, Yazid started to demand allegiance and his submission. And that was the main issue. Submission and allegiance mean Imam Hussain must accept what Yazid is doing, that is right.
You mean an that endorsement of the evil deeds that he was
making
in the name of Islam.
So if Imam Hussain was submitting his allegiance or accepting his demand, it's mean Imam Hussain was supporting all the inhuman practices of Yazid. So he refused to accept his demand.
And Dr. Shab, if I may add here, so you mean that if Imam Hussain would have endorsed what Yazid was wanting him to endorse, as you said, Hussain Aminni wa Namin al-Hussain, it would have been an endorsement on behalf of the Holy Prophet.
Exactly.
Is that what it is?
And that was not possible for personality like Hussain to submit himself in front of personality like Yazid. Very interestingly, when he was talking with Yazid, he once said that a person like me cannot accept person like Yazid. He declared that Hussain or Yazid are not two individuals. In fact, these are two approaches, and these approaches are remain still in our own society, because when we are using the word Hussain, now it is Hussainiyat, Hussainism, or Yazid, Yazidism. So those who are following those inhuman practices till now, are favoring those things, they are followers of that Yazidism. And those who are still confronting in front of those inhuman practices, they are part of this Hussainism or Hussainiyat.
Doctor, can I rephrase it, what you just said, and please correct me if I'm mistaken. You just said that anyone who is following the right path so shown by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and standing fast on the principles taught by Quran happens to be a Hussaini. And anyone who is contesting it or contending it by the virtue of his practice does not stand with Hussain, and he is
of course, in the opposite
lobby.
They may be declaring themselves as a Muslim, but at that time, like Yazid, he was also declaring himself as a Muslim. But they were hypocrites or munafiq.
Dr. Shab, help us to understand. Imam Hussain took a stand against Yazid and which eventually ended up in the Battle of Karbala that we are today talking about. But why he had his little children with him, and why he had his woman with him, and why it was because being the grandson of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just by reminding this hadith to the people of Arabia, he could have pulled out 1 million people. Yes, so why he was so isolated, and why he had his children with him, if he was essentially out for a war?
Yes, you have raised very very interesting question, and this is a very important aspect of incident of Karbala, because usually we understand Karbala as a battle. That was not a battle, because battle, if we accept that as a battle, battle needs to equal parties. But you know, when Yazid demanded his allegiance, Imam Hussein was at that time busy in performing Hajj or pilgrimage in Mecca. So he felt that if he is refusing this allegiance, he will be killed inside the mosque. And inside the mosque, particularly Masjid al-Haram, that is...
You mean inside Kaaba?
Yes, of course. So that was the sacred place. So he left incomplete his pilgrimage, and he left from Mecca towards Karbala. His main objective was to avoid from bloodshed, particularly in Mecca, that was the holy city, and particularly in the Muslim society. So he migrated from Mecca towards Karbala. So when he moved from Mecca towards Karbala, and his main objective was to bring peace in the society, so he took his family, his children, female, along with a female member of his family, along with him towards Karbala. And during his migration,
so it was like
towards
a family migration?
Yes. Because during his migration, he had lot of attempts to send messages to Yazid and his followers not to involve in war with the Prophet's family, because they don't have anything to do with them. They are doing their own job, that is preaching of real Islamic teachings. And if you are doing your own job, we don't have anything to do with you. But they were understanding, Yazid and his followers were understanding, till the time Hussein is alive and Hussein is present, they will not be able to implement their inhuman practices, and they will not be able to impose their intentions in the society. Because Hussein and Husseinis were trying to preach original Islam that was conveyed by Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And when they reached to the Karbala, again, even they told them that try to avoid from war, but Yazid and his followers, and particularly commanders, were not accepting this demand, because their ultimate goal was to kill.
But Doctor, before we take to the event of Karbala, help me to understand why Imam Hussein initially started moving toward Najaf, and why did he then change his route toward Karbala? What happened in this meanwhile?
Actually, that is a long story, because he was invited by people from Kufa.
Kufa, I'm sorry. And I said Najaf, yes, it was Kufa originally.
That was Kufa. Okay. And from Kufa, he was invited by a lot of people, and they were declaring their intention that we will support you, and you must come to Kufa, and we will protect you. But when Imam Hussein sent his ambassador to people of Kufa to understand what is the environment there, those people were not able to come up with their loyalty, because they were not on mature level. So when they felt that Imam Hussein and those who are supporting Imam Hussein, they will be under threat, and they will be killed by Yazid. So they refused to support ambassador of Imam Hussein, that was Muslim bin Aqil. And he was killed in Kufa helplessly because he was alone there and nobody supported him. So that was the way. So it is very interesting for those who want to understand when Imam Hussain reached on certain point of during his travel. So one way was moving, one way was leading towards Karbala and other way was leading towards Kufa. The way which were leading towards Kufa, that was way of life. And the way which was leading towards Karbala, that was way of death. But today we know that those who move towards Kufa, they are died. And those who move towards Karbala, they were killed, but still they are alive.
Alive in the heart and
in the hearts and minds of the
and Dr. Shab, when he reached Karbala with the small children and with the woman of his family, they were originally not prepared for a war, they were not well armed. Then what happened in the course of these 3 days, and how did he eventually got assassinated or martyred with the hands of these non-believers?
Till his last time, Imam Hussain was trying to convey that his main objective is implementation of justice, implementation of human rights, implementation of equality, implementation of right Islamic and human practices. He was preaching till the last time, and these preachings are in fact, and these teachings are in fact, not particularly for certain school of thought. That was those were for all the human beings. But on the other hand, Yazid and his followers were insisting on their own inhuman practices and teachings. So they never accepted Imam Hussain's invitation for justice and peace. So that was the main conflict at that time. So Imam Hussain tried to set a new trend and new movement for human being, that if you are facing a time when on the one hand somebody is threatening your life and demanding for wrong practices, and on the other hand, you are facing the threat of death, but you have to stand on your own right views, so you must stand. So that is known as in Arabic terms, haq and batil, right and wrong. And that was the criteria for Imam Hussain. So Imam Hussain and his followers. So he stood on his haq or right path, and he very confidently declared that I will not accept any wrong thing from Yazid or his followers. So that was the main point of confrontation, and because of no compromise, he was attacked, but he defended himself very well, and his followers as well, they defended themselves very well. But unfortunately, at that time, those who were calling themselves as Muslims, they killed on the one hand 6-month-old Ali Asghar, the son of Imam Hussain. That he was only 6-month-old, and he was not able to fight, even he was not able to smile or cry, but he was killed by those people. And on the other hand, they killed old people, those who were also not able to fight like young people. And ultimately, they also attacked Imam Hussain himself, but they were not able to kill him during his war. So when he was in the state of prayer and he was not fighting with them, he was in sajda and he was offering his prayer, at that time they attacked and murdered him.
Dr. Shab, I have a very pertinent question for you and for all the people who are watching this program to understand. So to my understanding, on the night of Ashur, Imam Hussain switched off the lights and asked his people that the opponents are fighting against me. I am the one who they are looking as an enemy, and they have no enmity with anyone else in this camp. Okay. So all of them may leave, and if they leave, Imam Hussain will not hold them accountable for anything.
Yes.
That is one thing. And on, as you just said, Imam Hussain was the last man of his so-called army to be killed, which means the remaining 71 did not allow Imam Hussain to take the risk of his life till the last drop of their blood. What does this character of the companions of Imam Hussain tells us today?
Actually, that is, as I already mentioned, that Imam Hussain wanted to set new trend and new movement for those who wanted to follow truth, justice and peace. And those 71 people who were killed before Imam Hussain, they stood with Imam Hussain and they stood with justice, peace and human rights. And they were killed in this way. I believe that even they killed all of them, and this message was conveyed later on by Bibi Zainab, his sister, but on the ground they killed all of them. But particularly we can understand that today nobody knows about even grave of Yazid and his followers, but Imam Hussain is still alive in the hearts and minds of the people, not only Shia, not only Sunni, all the Muslim, all the human beings. Because today when we have the ceremony of Arbaeen in Karbala, I believe that millions of people are coming from Europe, Africa and Asia and all over the world. That is the sign that Imam Hussain stood for right path.
Dr. Saab, as you just mentioned about the very sacred name of the daughter of Imam Ali, Bibi Zainab Salamul Alaha. Ladies and gentlemen, this brings me to a very interesting point in this conversation. As we understand, all the history that you might have read in any book is actually his story. And this is how the word history makes. This means the story of the men who fought. And women largely remained unnoticed in the entire memory of history in the early era of human civilization. But when it comes to the story of Karbala, the woman he just named, Bibi Zainab Salamul Alaha, who was the daughter of Hazrat Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib and sister of Hazrat Imam Hussain, had a very significant and pertinent role in this story. To shed more light on it, I have invited a PhD scholar, a woman with a great appetite for Islamic literature. Her name is Ms. Mehreen Jahangiz. She is currently a PhD scholar from Qaid-e-Azam University. Ms. Mehreen, I welcome you to my program.
Thank you, Shabbat.
Mehreen, as you just have heard, we are talking about this great sacrifice of Karbala, and I want you to shed light on the beginning of the role of Bibi Zainab Salamul Alaha in this great story.
First of all, I would like to shed some light on her biography. It's very important to know who she was and how she was raised. She was a daughter of, as you have mentioned, daughter of Imam Ali and the granddaughter of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And she was born on 5th or 4th Hijra. Prophet was not present at that time in Medina. So when he came back after 3 days, he named her Zainab. That means the precious jewel of her father, or the one who glorifies the name of her father. And this name very truly fits to her personality. Now, beyond, we should go beyond to this biographical introduction to her. She was very eloquent. She was very well-learned. She was very courageous and brave lady. And she took a different trait from her father, from her mother, and from her grandmother, as she was the daughter of Hazrat Khadija. And she was, we all know that she was very successful businesswoman in a society, in a pre-Islamic society, that in which the woman did not have or could not exert her influence are exert the space to translate her wishes towards her life. But Hazrat Khadija was a distinguishable, and she was a unique example. So she took different traits from different personalities who were distinguishable and distinguished in their own capacities. So she was a composite of all these personalities, and she reflected all these traits and characteristics in the Battle of Karbala and after the Battle of the Karbala. So I would say that it was her that now we, the Muslims, or the human beings, the whole world, know the actual message of the Karbala. I think we, the Muslims, are socially and intellectually trained to focus more on the sufferings of the people who fought in Karbala, or who stood against the tyranny of Yazid. And when we look at the personality of Bibi Zainab, we confront this dilemma. And we forgot to capture and to capitulate the message for which the people of the Karbala, Imam Hussein or Bibi Sayyida Zainab, stood with his brother. It is very important.
So Mehreen, taking advantage of your presence in the show, can I request you to kindly shed light on the role that she has played in this great Battle of Karbala and beyond?
She was symbol of defiance. She was symbol of courage. She was symbol of patience, as we all know this. But the point that needs to be understood is her understanding towards the political makeup of that time, her understanding towards the political makeup, the political makeup an Islamic state should have. This is something that most of the scholars ignore. It was her understanding that made her stood with her brother. She was present in Karbala. She was advisor to Imam Hussein, the most important advisor to Imam Hussein. And after his martyrdom, she was a personality who kept the family of the Prophet together. She was a personality even who defended the last surviving son of Imam Hussein. And the most important point, I think the most important of all the things, is she was the one who led the caravan of family of the Prophet from Karbala to Damascus. She was the one who stood in defiance against all the sufferings, and she was the one to whom the family of the Prophet was looking towards. So,
Mehreen, you just mentioned. Mehreen, I'll have to cut you here, I'm sorry. But you just mentioned this journey that she led with the remaining family of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Tell us about the journey of agony and pain which started from Karbala, and how did it go forward and how did she lead it?
From Karbala to Damascus, the family of the Prophet, especially the women of the family of the Prophet, they experienced all the sufferings that in an uncivilized society a conqueror do to his conquest. The female has always been used, the woman has always been used for persecution and for event in all the victories in human history. The same was conducted with the family of the Prophet and the woman of the family of the Prophet. And she was the one who fearlessly resisted it. Like when they reached, the caravan reached to the court of the Yazid, one of the men in his court asked for a younger girl in the caravan. There is a debate that if the girl was the younger sister of Bibi Zainab or the youngest daughter of Imam Hussein. This was fearlessly resisted by Bibi Zainab. And at this point she spoke very well, and that reflected not only her understanding towards the whole scenario that led the family of the Prophet from Medina to Karbala and from Karbala to Damascus.
Mehreen, you just mentioned that she spoke very courageously in the court of Yazid And this speech that you just have mentioned still resonates in the memory of Islamic history. Can you tell us a bit more about what her stand was and what did she exactly say? Can you share some pieces of the abstract if possible?
She said, "You, O commander, whose authority are vilifying unjustly and oppressed with your authority." Now look at the words. These words are not expressing that she was lamenting on her suffering. No. She was actually questioning the authority of the Yazid. She was actually questioning the tyranny of Yazid. And at this point, she asked him that your woman, your wife, and your even slave girls are sitting behind the curtains. They're in veil. And you have put a stand in front of all these men. And we have gone through a number of bazaars and markets and from one city to another city, and everyone in our way was looking at us, was looking at the woman of the family of the Prophet. So here she not only expressed her we can say agony, but also she was rejecting the practice which was conducted by Yazid and his army to exploit the woman, to exploit the rights of the woman, from Karbala to Damascus. So for me,
Thank you, Mehreen. Thank you, Mehreen, for sharing all of this. Dr. Shab, your quick comments on what she just said about this speech and her stance in this court of
course, I think that the whole incident of Karbala and post-Karbala events have resulted to prevention of original teachings of Islam, and this whole incident resulted to death of Yazid and Yazidiyat. Very interestingly, in the end, I would like to mention a quote of one of the prominent Pakistani scholar. He said that it is not important why Imam Hussein refused to accept allegiance of Yazid, but it is important that when Imam Hussein refused to accept allegiance of Yazid, why others at that time accepted allegiance of Yazid?
Thank you very much, Dr. Shab, for enlightening us. Ladies and gentlemen, as we had this wonderful conversation, few points were very pertinent. And one of these points, so said by Dr. Kadil Saab, I'll steal his line. He said, this was not about Hussein and Yazid in their persons. This is between right and wrong. The lines are still drawn. We are still living in a world where the wrong is very, very obvious, and it is still haunting the lives of the people. The sufferings of humanity are even today immense. These days of Muharram remind us of the great sacrifice made by the family of Holy Prophet to stand by the principles that have been taught to us. So these days must remind us our duty as Muslims to stand by these principles that we have been taught and that we will be asked about on the Day of Judgment. Thank you very much for watching our program. Allah Hafiz.
Shaheed Karbala hai ye, Rasool ki dua hai ye, Hussain o minni wa ana min al-Hussain.